This is Mark Kepler with Purdue Extension Service. What we're going to be doing over the next several programs here is taking a look at how to develop a garden, a vegetable garden at your own house. Why are we out in the woods today? And that's the question we're going to answer as we go into this program. Because it's important to think about, as we develop a vegetable garden, a little bit of history. That's right, going back in the history of Indiana and going back to the time when the pioneers first came into this area. When the pioneers came into Indiana, 87% of the state was trees. Because 87% of the state was trees, they came in here, they started chopping trees down, and they started farming around it. And what those pioneers found in the soils that we have here is the fact that those soils were just great soils to produce crops, to produce vegetables, to have their families live and enjoy life in Indiana. And so we're going to start this thing off by talking about the woods and what people would find in the woods and what about the soils of Indiana were so great. By the way, by the time the pioneers came into here in the early 1800s, again, 87% trees. By the year 1900, they had this state down to only 8% trees. They were very, very efficient in what they were doing, and they realized that Indiana was a great place to grow crops and to raise a family. Indiana is also a great place to have a garden too. So let's talk about this soil that we're upon here. This soil was developed under a forest situation. That means there were thousands of years of trees. Let's go clear back to the Ice Age. Oh, a little over 10,000 years ago, that great big sheet of ice came in here and wiped out this whole area. And since that time, our soils have developed under a forest situation that slowly came back into here. The thing to understand about trees in a forest are, we always think about they're very, very deep rooted. And they do have some roots go down very deep. In fact, trees such as oak trees have those big old tap roots that kind of go down in the ground. But the vast majority of the roots of that tree are in the top foot of the ground. And so what's happened here for thousands of years is the leaves have fell off the trees and dropped to the soil. The roots have gone out from those trees. And as those trees rotted away, the roots send up little tiny little white hair roots. And those little white hair roots then recycle those leaves, or in other words, they use up those leaves and they break them down. At the same time, there were a variety of different insects in this area that were also degrading that soil. So in that top foot of the ground where those tree roots are at, those tree roots have been growing and then they die and they rot. And that rotted earth, that rotted soil, is something we call organic matter. That is the key to what I'm talking about today. And this is the key to growing a garden, and it is the key to having any kind of a growing enterprise when we deal with the soil, is the organic matter, that rotted area that's down into the soil. And so that's what we had. By the way, just kind of a sidelight, when those pioneers came in here and they came into that woods, it wasn't looking kind of like the one we have here today. It was great big huge trees and it was very fluffy. The soil was very fluffy. And the reason it was very fluffy is because there weren't earthworms at that time. When those big old massive sheets of ice came through in that glacier time, they took out those earthworms at the time too. And so we had very fluffy soil. What the pioneers brought with them was earthworms, and now today we see lots of night crawlers and a lot of different kind of earthworms in our soils. And they're really interesting because they add to our soils, because they go up, they get a bite, and they pull it down of that leaf mass, and they pull it down into the soil, and they recycle it down into the soil and they bring it down into there. So it's a really neat thing that we're looking at. And so let's take a look at what some of this soil would look like. Well, I brought along with me a shovel. I wanted you to have a take a look at what these soils really looked like in a forest long before they came along and started plowing them up, and how much organic matter was in these soils. So I'm going to dig up a little bit of earth here, and we're going to bring it up and we're going to take a look at it, and we're going to see what's here. First thing I'm going to take a look at on this soil is the fact that it's dark in color. That's what that organic matter does. That rotting, it goes away, brings in that darkness to our soil. So anytime you're looking at a soil that's lighter colored, it lacks of the organic matter. But the darkness here is what brings in our organic matter into this soil. The other thing about these soils were, when they develop under this situation, they aren't just pulverized dirt. They have a lot of structure to them. For example, you can break them away, and as you break them away, they fall into little things we call peds and clods. Everything breaks up and everything falls away in it. That's the nature of the soil. By having that soil that falls away and breaks up like that, our roots of our plants can penetrate down through the channels. Channels left by old roots that have died, channels left by earthworms that have got into it and have also died or developed it. And so our soils, it would really be nice when we get into our soils if we can maintain that structure we refer to in these soils, and the ability to hold together and the ability to fall into little peds like we're looking at. Beautiful, beautiful soil when we get into a forest situation. So as I've pointed out already, the key to this is organic matter. No matter whether you have a sandy soil or a clay soil, the thing you need to do to make it better is to add this black organic into that soil. Sometimes I hear people with sandy soil say, I just want to dump a load of clay in there. The reality of that is, with sand mixed with clay, sometimes gives you bricks. And I've ran into a lot of people in my career who have done that, where they've dumped a load of sand in there or a load of clay in their sand, and it does not work out. Another thing that sometimes happens is people have an opportunity to hear about, oh, I can buy some topsoil. Well, topsoil doesn't have a tremendous amount of organic matter in it. It may have 5, 6, 7% organic matter in it. And so I really tell people, unless you're doing raised beds where you need some dirt or you're filling in a low spot, the key is not adding topsoil, but adding organic matter. And that's why I'm standing here at the Solid Waste District, taking a look behind me at all the piles of composted leaves that they have out here. One of the greatest things we can do with our leaves, rather than dragging them off and stick them in a landfill, is to bring them out to a place like this where they have an opportunity to compost them and compost them down, and then you can take something like this and add it into your soil and add it into that organic matter into your own soil. Now, you can do your own backyard composting. That's a great thing too, and you can develop your own and use your own leaves that way rather than having to let government do it for you. Let's take a look at some of this well rotted down composted leaves we have here. That's the black. See the black that we have here? This is not quite ready yet. It's got a little bit left to do, but all we've done here is taken away a tremendous amount of those fibers that hooked all those leaves together have been broken down into this blackness. And adding this black into my soil then will improve my soil and will give it a couple of different things. Number one, this organic matter will add air to it. It's just that fluff factor that you want to think about. But just having that fluff will allow you to get air into it. So it'll give it air, increase drainage. And the other thing that organic matter does is it holds on to nutrients. Now, that's kind of a tough thing to think about, and it gets very scientific. But the fertilizers that we put on that soil, they can be lost. But this organic matter holds on to those nutrients and holds them in our soil a lot better. So it gives us ability to absorb water. It gives us some fluff or some air in there also. It gives us the ability to hold on to nutrients. This organic matter also has a little bit of nitrogen left over in it. It's going to help fertilize our soils. And so it is really the stuff that you want to have. Think back, if you ever see any of those big time gardening programs, they always go to somebody on television. They always go to somebody's place that has this nice, fluffy, loose soil. This is what gives it that great soil. This is organic matter. And so whether you do it yourself or come out here or you buy a bag of peat moss or you spread some peat moss in your garden, that's another thing that you can do. These are different ways that you can add organic matter. Or there's another aspect that you can look at. Somebody has something like cattle manure, horse manure, or rabbit manure, all those things, if they're composted, in other words, you set them in a pile and let them go through a heat and a process for maybe 5, 6 months where they rot down some, those things will also contribute organic matter in your soil, and it's a great thing to add to your soil. So right here, first place you start, thinking about any kind of garden is thinking about getting some organic into the soils. Okay, this is Mark Kepler with Purdue Extension Service here in Rochester and Fulton County. And so we're going to take a look at today thinking about putting out a garden. If we're just thinking about putting out a garden in our backyard or somewhere else, well, what is going to be the parts that we're going to have to think about in this whole process? So I came here to this lot. It's right across from Riddle School, and we're going to be taking a look at this and thinking about this lot here. Maybe I just want to put a garden out here. So here's some of the things we got to think about. Number one, garden plants love to have full sun. So as much sun as we can possibly give, that's what we want to have. And so we don't want to have shade trees around. We want to get it out here in the full sun. Number two, can we get some wind? Can we get some blowing of the wind out here? Why do I really care about the wind? Wind, as it develops and blows, dries plants out. So this morning we had a pretty heavy dew left over from yesterday's rain, and so those plants that are staying wet will stay wet a long time into the morning. If I've got wind and I've got sunlight, I can dry my plants out quicker, which is good from a disease standpoint. One of the conditions I've always seen in tomatoes, every year get this disease where it causes a fungus disease, where it causes the plant to kind of die from the ground up. And as the summer goes on, it keeps dying and dying. And by the time we get to the fall of the year, the plant has died off. I always see that as a worse problem in town than out in the country. And the reasoning behind that is in town, we don't get near the winds that we get out in the country. We don't get near the drying that goes on. Plus, there's a lot more shade from houses, from trees in our area. So we really got to watch that we get the most sunniest area we can for putting our garden in. The other thing is, as we take a look at this spot we have here, we need to take a look at the soil itself. We don't ever want to plant a garden in a low area. And two reasons for that. One of those reasons is a low area will also be subject to frost. In other words, in the fall of the year and the spring of the year, when we get those cool nights, the lower the spot, the quicker they frost. So our season is a lot shorter in a low area. So I don't want to put my garden anywhere where it's down in a low spot on my. And I've seen this happen before where people plant it out of the way, somewhere back on their place, and it's in a low spot. Keep your garden out of that. You want your garden up on a hill or a side of a hill if you can at all possibly do that. So most of us don't have that option, but even within our yard, we have areas that are lower and are maybe too wet, and we have areas that are higher. Try to plan for the sunny, high area of that soil. So that's one of the things we want to look at more than anything, is to make sure that we get those gardening areas that are up and not down low, because down low is bad news in the long run. Let's take a look at a few other things that we might want to do to this piece of ground before we put a garden into it. Well, we're going to take a look at a few things that we might want to do to this ground before we put a garden into it. One of those things I'm going to talk to you about is the weeds or the grass or whatever vegetation is out here already existing. Now, I could come out here and I could just get my rototiller out and I could just rototill an area and start rototilling it. But one of the things you're going to run into is that old vegetation is there. Is it something that I have to worry about in the long run? Just by rototilling it, I may not have an opportunity for it to all go away. And this is a perfect example of what I see that happens in this. So I'm going to dig up a little bit of this ground down here, and I'm going to bring up some of the weeds. And here's one of the weeds that's growing in this soil. Take a look at this root coming out of this grass growing here. That root is what we call a rhizome. And off of each one of those little nodes on that rhizome, a new plant will develop. So if I come out here with my rototiller and chop this thing all up, I have just chopped it into my many little tiny plants. And because I got all these little tiny plants, it'll come right back onto me. And so this whole thing has got a variety of those different ones in here, and we can pull it apart and we can take a look, and here's a rhizome popping out here on the side, and that rhizome is going to develop into some more of this quack grass is here that's going to continue. So what I have to do is I need to take care of this somehow. I need to kill this, and rototilling isn't going to kill it because it's going to pop back from them nodes. So what we're going to end up doing, my recommendation, is use a herbicide out here, a herbicide that goes into the plant and goes down to the roots and kills the roots off. So that herbicide, and the only one really out there that does do the job on that, is one that goes by the brand name of Roundup, or it has the chemical name called glyphosate. And so there's a lot of different generic versions of Roundup out there, and you need to look for that product. When I spray Roundup on this area, it kills virtually everything green it comes in contact with. And it translocates, in other words, it moves within the plant down into those roots. And it has no soil activity. It doesn't work on the soil. A seed that's right next to it can germinate tomorrow and come right up, because the Roundup is not going to work, because the Roundup is actually tied up by that soil. And so I want to spray this with Roundup. So if I was thinking about making this area into a garden, maybe in the fall I would come out here, spray the area with Roundup, wait a week, see what's going on, see what's happening, maybe come back again, and we're talking this might be October here, come back again, see if I missed some spots, or see if some of these rhizomes didn't get killed and are popping back up, and spray it again with some Roundup, and I would have it killed off in the fall, and then it can rot away all winter long, and this sod that we have can rot away, so that when I rototill it in the spring, it'll be easier to rototill. So that's the kind of thing that I would look at doing with that herbicide. Again, it has no soil activity. Well, let's say I don't want to use a herbicide. I'd rather do something else. Well, then I think probably the only other answer is what we call smothering. And that is laying a tarp out here, shutting off the sunlight, putting a tarp over it. Black plastic would do a job too, where it has to be underneath that black plastic and you smother it out. And again, that ought to be done sometime the year before, and maybe that'll smother out this plant where it doesn't have any more sunlight coming to it, and that would work also. So in a small area, I could use that, and that would be my organic way of doing that. Okay, let's just do a little bit of looking at this lot in general here. We're going to walk across this lot and see where it might be the opportunity to plant our best soil or put our best garden in. So now I'm in a spot. It's a very low spot. As we look down at this spot, let's just dig up a little bit of this ground. Well, first off, we see some ant mounds around here. We'll dig up a little bit of this ground and we'll take a look at it. Really sandy. No color to it whatsoever, lacks organic matter. There was a house in this lot at one time. Maybe when they dug up the house and buried it, they ended up with this very, very sandy soil. This soil is so poor, it doesn't even grow good weeds here in this location. So this may not be the spot that I want to put my garden at. Plus, it's a little bit on the low side. Let's walk across this lot a little bit further. We're a little bit farther over to the south on this lot. I've dug down in a spot here, got a little bit better vegetation. Let's take a look at this soil. Sandy soil also, but darker in color. See the darkness in here? This has been something that has been less disturbed. A little bit on a higher standpoint too, or a little bit off the ground. So this might be a better location to put my lot at, or my gardening, or my flower bed at in this location right here. Let's take a look at some other places across here too. As we take a look at this lot, we see that there's an area over there that's a little bit higher. As you look at that higher area over there, you think maybe that's a good location to place my garden. But now take a look. See the trees in that area? That's right. Over on the right, you'll have a whole bunch of trees growing over there. And those trees are a shady location. So if I put a garden on that part of my lot, I'm going to have shade part of the year. So I probably want to stay away from there. But I do want to have a good soil on a high location. And so in order to do that, maybe we want to find a spot that's just like that last one we looked at and dug at. That's probably a best location on this lot. It's high and the soils look very, very good there. Got some dark color to them. I'm Mark Kepler with Purdue University Extension Service, and my office is located here in Rochester at the fairgrounds. I write a column for the Rochester Sentinel. It shows up each Friday. And today I'm going to go over and I'm going to read one of those columns from May 23rd of 2014. And the title of the column is
A Tale of Two Insecticides. Charles Dickens wrote a famous book, The Tale of Two Cities. I'm going to modify and modernize that title into The Tale of Two Insecticides. The story has been repeated several times with various names and multiple derivatives. It starts out with the discovery of a natural biological insecticide. This insecticide is discovered to be effective against certain pests, but it has its limitations. It does not act very long, or it breaks down easily. That's where the chemist enters the spot. Working in the lab, they find a way to modify the organism to enhance its positive points and develop the second insecticide. The classic example of this is pyrethrum, a naturally occurring insecticide found in a certain type of chrysanthemum called a Dalmatian chrysanthemum. It's not the type we normally grow in our area. Scientists working off of that basic chemistry have developed a variety of synthetic products that are longer lasting and more specific for certain uses. Many products available in local stores are based upon this chemistry. The insecticide spinosad is a chemical derived in the 1970s. It was isolated from soil collected inside a sugarcane mill and a rum distillery in the Virgin Islands. It's a natural compound derived from the fermentation of a bacteria. It is considered a natural organic insecticide. Since the finding of this product, chemists have developed over 200 synthetic variations. What is neat about this product is that it seems to be more active on insect bad guys than on the good guys. For example, it is the product of choice for fly control and bagworm on evergreens. Previous column that I did talked about spotted wing Dropsilla mentions it as one of the potential controls. At the same time, it does not harm ladybugs and praying mantis. It is now even available as a flea powder for use on your dog or head lice in human. So it is a very safe product to use. I think we will be seeing a lot about this product in the future as it becomes more and more available and easier to find. What I found out is that it's hard to find spinosad locally. When you do go to look for it, you have to look on the label and go through all the label dressing and all the different brand names and get down to the part that says active ingredient. There you will see the name spinosad. Spin-o-sad. I hope the tale of this product is a long, successful one, and soon you will not have to travel to a different city to find it. I'm Mark Kepler, Purdue University Extension Service in Rochester, Indiana. Thank you.